Have you ever asked yourself about a friend or family member? Is it just normal memory loss? Or is it Alzheimer's? How can we tell? How can anything be done to avoid or delay this cruel disease? That's our subject for today. Stay tuned.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program by and for seniors, and devoted to exploring the many facets of those better years of our lives. The name of our program is inspired by a quotation from Robert Browning. Grow old along with me, the best is yet to be, the last of life for which the first was made. Now, sit back and enjoy a program made especially to provide seniors with useful information, plus some lighter moments to brighten your day.
If we can delay the onset of Alzheimer's by 5 years, only five, we can then have 50% less people affected by this disease.
As we age, we get forgetful. We have trouble with people's names. We forget where we put things. We may ask ourselves that dreaded question, is it Alzheimer's? Carter Wells was a member of the Better Part. He died in 2003 of Alzheimer's. His wife Marjorie is convinced that early interception is the key. Today, I'm making good on a promise that I made to her, and we'll learn about identifying the disease early and if there's anything that can be done to delay or prevent the disease. My guest is William Fisher, CEO of the Alzheimer's Association, based in Mountain View, California. Thank you for coming, Bill.
Happy to be with you.
We will be including footage of a presentation by Edie Yao. From the Alzheimer's Association, I'd like to introduce Edie Yao. Edie, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, my name is Edie. I work for the Alzheimer's Association, and I've been there for about 4 years, and my title there is Area Director of Diversity.
Do you and your staff regularly go out into the community, Bill?
Oh, yes. Part of our mission is to do the sort of thing you're talking about here, which is to raise people's awareness about Alzheimer's, let them know they're not alone, and give people better information. We believe very strongly that education and information enables people to cope with this journey better than they might otherwise.
Marjorie said that interception was the key in identifying, mm-hmm. and you have this brochure here called Is It Alzheimer's? Mm-hmm. And here are the 10 warning signs that we should know. Can we just go through each one of those?
Sure.
Okay, so memory loss, number one.
Well, memory loss is the hallmark of Alzheimer's, and specifically short-term memory loss, not long-term memory. Your long-term memories and your short-term memories are stored differently in the brain, so people will forget the things that have happened recently. How long have we been at this? I'm sorry, who are you? Have we had breakfast? Have we had lunch? They'll forget the story they're in the midst of, that sort of thing. And they may remember long-term memories quite well. My grandmother had Alzheimer's. When I was in college, I'd come home and visit and say, hey, Grandma, it's me, Billy. And she'd say, oh, I have a grandson named Billy. Mm. But the grandson that was 20 years old, she didn't remember. The grandson she recalled was this, you know, probably 3 or 4 year old person.
Right. So number two, difficulty performing familiar tasks.
Yeah. And again, familiar tasks probably relate to short-term memory. Bill paying, work. Work is one of the more complex things that human beings engage in, and if you're still working when you start to develop problems, that's where we're likely to see difficulties first.
When someone has dementia, they are not able to do the regular tasks that are required of them at a job. An example would be if a librarian were to have dementia, and we knew of a librarian who did, one of her tasks is to change the date for the due dates on books and stamp the books. And one day, she was not able to change the date anymore. She just couldn't figure out how to work the date changer. That was a huge indicator for her husband that there was something going on here.
When we finish this interview, I go back to the office tomorrow. I pick up the messages I'm in the midst of, the projects I'm in the midst of. I don't have to have someone stand over my shoulder and remind me what tasks to follow on. People with Alzheimer's will start to have problems with those sorts of things. Bill paying. Not uncommon for us to get a call from an adult child saying, Mom's gotten a threatening letter about turning off the electricity. Mm. They say she hasn't paid the bill. She has plenty of money. But bill paying, you and I take for granted. But it's a sequential task. You need to think and act sequentially, and that's predicated on short-term memory.
Right. Okay. Number three, problems with language.
Yeah, again,
I have it all the time.
Well, problems with word finding is a typical, you know, that's a very pretty there, what you have on. I can describe it, but I can't say blouse. I can't find the noun I'm looking for.
So do you find people compensate then and say the word for you?
Oh, sure. Absolutely.
So then we could not figure that this is Alzheimer's because somebody else is disguising it by answering
sure.
for them.
And it's important to keep in mind that with any of these individual items we talk, I'm sure that the viewers hear us talk about this and some of them will say, oh gosh, that happens to me.
To me, right.
And of course these things do.
Right.
We all have problems with a word or a name or something from time to time. It's when you see several of these items in a cluster and they happen repeatedly. And then these problems start to get in the way of living our lives independently. That's when we start to see real problems.
Right. So disorientation to time and place.
Again, when I wake up in the morning, do I know where I am? Do I know what I'm about? You know, you woke up this morning and before you got out of bed, you knew whether you were retired yet. You knew whether you had to go to school or to work. People with Alzheimer's, if, for example, it makes travel difficult. But you go to a foreign, you know, to another town and you're in a hotel and you wake up in the middle of the night, you need to use the washroom. Do you remember where you are, why you're here, and where the washroom is?
Right.
That can be disorienting. People with Alzheimer's will deal with that stress less well than a well person will.
Right. Poor or decreased judgment?
Poor or decreased judgment. An example of this would be often grandparents watch babies or children, right? And it's common to, if you're on the phone or in the middle of an activity, you suddenly forget to observe the child and see where the child is. Someone with dementia may entirely forget about that child and walk out of the house to go visit with a neighbor.
Judgment is predicated a lot on memory. If I want to get something to eat, I have to remember a whole lot of things about, do I have money in my pocket? Have I been to the ATM recently? Is it time to eat? Where will I find that food? And then executing all of those short-term memory pieces. So decisions usually have lots of pieces that accumulate in a judgment, right? People with Alzheimer's will have problems with that. So they'll have problems with making legal, financial, healthcare decisions.
Problems with abstract thinking.
Yeah, again, that...
Which is what you've covered a little bit
yeah,
with the checkbook.
That's right. That's right. To pull things together to is a fairly complex cognitive process to deal with abstractions. And people with Alzheimer's are going to have problems with that. And you have to stay on task to do it, right?
Right.
And again, that's a problem for people with Alzheimer's.
Misplacing things.
And why are you here today?
Well, I'm going to be 87 in April, and I find that I'm putting things away and forgetting where I put them, so I thought I better go to the class and see what's going on.
Well, that's pretty straightforward. We put things somewhere and we forget. And again, all of us do that from time to time. We're busy, we have lots of things going on in our lives. People with Alzheimer's will do this repeatedly, and the problems will become so pronounced that it'll get in the way of their activities of daily living.
Changes in mood or behavior.
Yeah, and again, that's pretty typical of dementia. It's typical of Alzheimer's disease. This varies quite a bit, by the way, in people with Alzheimer's, so it's not true for everyone that the mood swings are going to be the same, but it's a very common phenomena. Now, again, there'll be people out there watching this and say, well, gosh, you know, I went through that at some time in my life. And that can be true. Depression can cause that. Stress can cause that. Lots of other things can cause that. But it's when it's coupled as part of this syndrome where we see these other things going on as well that it causes us to be concerned.
changes in personality.
And again, that goes with changes in mood, I think. And people with Alzheimer's will have, I always think anxiety is sort of the emotional hallmark in the early going of the disease, because they're forgetting a lot of things and it's stressful to them. And imagine what that would be like for you if all of a sudden you didn't remember who this person was you were talking to, or how long they'd been sitting there, or where you were. It'd be sort of frightening, and your anxiety level would be high because this is happening to you with some frequency. And so it may affect your mood, it may affect your personality. You may be agitated more often, you may become paranoid and suspicious. I lose things, people are taking them. That might be the explanation that you come up with for why you can't find your pocketbook or your checkbook or your keys. And in fact, you've forgotten, and you may have forgotten that you're forgetting.
And number 10, loss of initiative.
It's common for many of us to just maybe get tired of doing housework, or not feel like doing our work, or not feeling like planning a party this Christmas, okay? But someone with dementia loses the initiative altogether. You'll notice that someone with dementia may just not be able to get themselves together. So an example would be my friend's grandmother who had dementia. She said, you know, she used to go to the grocery store every week, plan out the list, be able to do that on a regular basis, and very social. And all of a sudden, that wasn't happening. She would go to the grocery store, not even know which aisle to go in for certain ingredients, even though it's the same grocery store she's been going to for 20 years.
If I just sit here, I'm okay. I'm doing all right. If you ask me if I want to go somewhere, I may say no because I'm not quite sure exactly what's involved in that. Again, it goes back to judgment somewhat and memory. Not everyone will have profound personality changes. Not everyone will have profound mood swings. Everyone will start to have difficulties with activities of daily living as the disease progresses. I think for families, again, the important takeaway from this is that when you see a series of these 10 things, maybe we see 3, 4, 5 of these symptoms together, and we see them over time, it's worth paying attention and asking the physician about the symptoms and being quite clear about what we've noticed. Write these things down. These are the things I've noticed with mom or dad or my wife or my husband. And I'd like some explanation for these things, doc. That's a hard thing for the person with the condition, by the way. Sometimes they are, there's a lot of denial in Alzheimer's, both on the parts of caregivers and on the part of the people with the condition. Alzheimer's is definitely an age-related condition. Approximately 1% of the population under 65, 10% of the population over 65, and according to the National Institute of Aging, 47% of the population over 85. So it's very much an age-related condition. With every decade, we see more and more of it. You know, I've encountered family members, people who are, I think the youngest person I've personally dealt with was a 38-year-old woman, dealt with people in their 40s and 50s. These stick out, however, in our minds because they're the unusual cases. It's much more common to see people, again, over 80 with this disease. That's why we see so much more of it, by the way. 4.5 million Americans with Alzheimer's today, 16 million Americans projected by the middle of this century, because, in an odd sense, Alzheimer's is the good news. We're living in large numbers into the at-risk population.
Mm-hmm. What about the split between men and women? Are women more likely to get it, or?
Yes, women are slightly more likely to get it. It's not a huge difference, but even when you account for the fact that women live in much larger numbers into the at-risk age group, right, women live longer, mm-hmm. You still see that women more frequently than men. It's not, again, it's not a striking difference, but there is some difference.
I'm Barbara Schwalbach, and I'm here to find out more about Alzheimer's, as my mother was diagnosed in 1992. She's still living, and that's over 12 years, and I always like to learn more, and also to know that I could possibly be carrying this gene myself, so it's important for me to get more facts and to know more about the Alzheimer's.
And is it genetic? Can I inherit it?
That's an important question to tease out a little bit.
Okay.
So the answer is yes, there's definitely a genetic aspect to Alzheimer's disease. Bill Jagus was head of neurology at UC Davis, and I like to quote Bill's comment, the way to avoid Alzheimer's disease, choose your parents and don't live too long. That is to say, the primary risk factors for Alzheimer's are age and genetics. Having said that, there are other issues that we're starting to understand that may modify our risk. But so there's a genetic aspect to Alzheimer's disease, period. That's not the same thing as saying that it's a hereditary disease. There are a small subset of people, probably fewer than 5% of the 4.5 million Americans with Alzheimer's, who have a purely genetically linked hereditary, what we would call a familial form of Alzheimer's disease. But it's not as simple as saying if my mother had Alzheimer's disease and she developed problems at 78 that I'm going to get it. It's not that clear at all.
I have an article here from the Kaiser Foundation. It's called Give Your Brain a Workout. And it says that a study published in the New England Journal of Medicine showed that people older than 75 were less likely to develop dementia if they regularly engaged in leisure activities such as reading, playing board games, playing musical instruments, or dancing. Can we do anything to keep our brains in good shape and stop them from dying?
The data says yes. And actually, you know, I've worked in Alzheimer's disease for 18 years. Over about the last 4 years, the most exciting area of Alzheimer's science really is the accumulation of data that suggests there are things we can do to alter our risk of developing Alzheimer's. And it has to do exactly with that sort of thing. The data suggests that what's good for our heart is also good for our brain, that both mental stimulation, physical exercise, taking care of our body, watching our cholesterol, watching our blood pressure, watching our homocysteine levels, and social interaction, social connectedness. And it's not just one finding, it's a series of pieces that are accumulating, as I say, to drive us in this direction. So you're starting to see a great deal of emphasis in our world on just that sort of thing, on what we call maintain your brain. Things that people, you know, I'm in my 50s, people, the baby boom generation, can do to maintain brain health and possibly reduce their risk of developing Alzheimer's disease.
Does what we eat or taking vitamins help prevent?
Well, there's some suggestion, again, that diet makes a difference. Things that are good for our heart are good for our brain. That's the sort of takeaway message here. And getting up and exercising, taking care of our body, seems to have some benefit in terms of brain health as well. So things that will be good for our weight, good for our cholesterol level, good for our blood pressure. And we think, again, that this ties into the science around maintain your brain, that we're starting to see that people, that lifestyle alters the risk. Again, we can't do anything about the genetics and the age part, but there are some things in the middle there that we think can influence brain health and our risk of Alzheimer's.
Right. And what about everyday stress, day-to-day stress? How does that affect you?
Well, stress can cause some of the symptoms we talked about in terms of memory loss and confusion and apathy and depression, right? So stress affects all of us. It affects young people, middle-aged people, and old people. There is some data that's just emerging, and the jury is out on this, but there's some data that suggests that stress may also be a risk factor for Alzheimer's disease. Again, not causing it in and of itself, but may be part of that constellation of things that increases our risk. So yes, we're paying attention to stress in a way that we didn't 5-10 years ago.
Yeah. Well, actually, my aunt has been diagnosed with Alzheimer's, and it appeared to happen or come to the surface about a year after my uncle died.
Yeah.
Is that a normal event?
Yes.
That might trigger Alzheimer's?
Very common. And again, what I think happens here is that it's not that it triggers Alzheimer's, is that there's a major stressor in life. And we have done two things in this scenario. We've lost a spouse, or my mother-in-law has Alzheimer's, and the incident in her life, she was living independently until she was 92, fell and broke a hip, went in the hospital, was never the same after that. So those are common stories. A hospital stay, we moved mom or dad across the country to live with us, or the death of a spouse. In the case of a spouse, the spouse was probably compensating for some degree. The symptoms were there. These are folks who have very thin coping skills. They're not coping as well with stress as they did once. And now we've added a major stressor, and we've taken away a support in the spouse. And so all of a sudden the family is seeing we've added stress to that person, so they're not coping as well. Their activities are not, they're not functioning as well. And also the family is closer to that person now, and maybe they're seeing things that they were protected from before.
Are there any diseases that look like Alzheimer's that are not, that actually can be cured?
Oh, absolutely. That's a good, very good question. About 1 in 10 cases of senile dementia, dementia in a person over the age of 65, can be treated and reversed. And what might those things be? They're things like depression. Sometimes depression can cause the confusion and apathy that looks like dementia, that is dementia, looks like Alzheimer's disease. Thyroid problems, thyroid deficiency. Contraindicated medications. Maybe someone is seeing 3 physicians taking 10 medications. In an older population, this is not unusual. And no one physician may be monitoring the medication load. 2 of those meds may be contraindicated, should not be taken together, and when taken together, cause dementia. The people are confused, they look like they're the early going of Alzheimer's disease, and when you get someone to focus on that, clear up the medication load, people can respond very well. So absolutely, one of the important things for us is that if a family's concerned about this, don't just ignore it. Get with your physician, ask for an assessment, because we wouldn't want to miss one of those 1 in 10 issues that can be treated.
Just want to clarify something. When you say senile dementia, you said senile just means over 65.
That's right.
And does dementia mean being forgetful, or does it mean you've got something wrong with you?
Dementia is abnormal aging. So there's normal aging, which is this age-associated cognitive impairment. It means we're not going to remember as quickly as we used to, but we're going to remember, right? We go to the store for and we forget some of the items. But people with dementia are going to go to the store and lose their way home. They're going to start to have problems. They're not going to remember the answer, but they're not going to remember the question either. You forget something now, and on the way home this evening, it's going to come back to you when you stop stressing over it. That's a normal, healthy aging memory. But dementia is just a syndrome. It describes the symptoms. It doesn't tell us what causes it. It's not a disease. What we want to ask the physician is what's causing this problem. So Alzheimer's, far and away the most common cause of dementia in people over 65. There are other causes of dementia, Lewy body dementia, L-E-W-Y, Parkinson's dementia, frontal temporal lobe dementia, Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, which is the viral condition related to mad cow disease that got such a lot of press here a while back, which is, by the way, a very rare condition. And then, as I said earlier, there are these treatable and reversible causes of dementia that are a group all to themselves.
All people with Alzheimer's disease have dementia, but not all people with dementia have Alzheimer's. It could be, the cause could be Alzheimer's, it could be related, some kind of related disorder, it could be a reversible disorder, and 1 out of 10 times it is a treatable cause of dementia.
So we're learning a lot about Alzheimer's.
Absolutely.
And what about diagnosis centers? That was something else that Edie mentioned in her presentation.
Yeah. You mentioned that we're learning a lot. It's important to emphasize that most of what we know about Alzheimer's disease we've learned in the last 15 years. It's a very new field, and that the data, the knowledge, the science is accumulating rapidly. We're learning to diagnose it better. When I started with the Alzheimer's Association, we used to say the only certain way to diagnose Alzheimer's was at autopsy. We don't say that anymore. A good clinical workup can be over 90% accurate.
Diagnostic centers. We are fortunate that in the Bay Area we have access to a number of diagnostic centers. We have UCSF, we have Stanford, we have in the East Bay there's UC Davis, Fresno, there's one. So the closest ones are UCSF and Stanford to us.
Can we prevent Alzheimer's? If we prevent strokes, can we prevent Alzheimer's?
Or? Well, again, the notion of maintaining your brain is based on the idea that by staying physically active, mentally active, and socially engaged, we can alter our risk of Alzheimer's. There's no simple thing that we can tell people. take this vitamin, eat this diet, and we can promise that you won't develop Alzheimer's or that you'll develop it 5 years later than you would have otherwise. Again, science over the last 4 years is suggesting that we can, in fact, alter our risk of developing Alzheimer's, which is something we didn't know before.
How do we contact the Alzheimer's Association?
Well, many ways. We're pretty easy to get a hold of. We're chapters across the country. So if your mom or dad or brother and sister are out of state, please get in touch with us. Contact us at 1-800-660-1993 or come to our website. Our national website is alz.org. Our local website is alznorcal.org.
And is that 24 hours a day, 7 days a week,
That's
the telephone
right.
number?
That's right.
So if we need any help at all?
Call us.
Call you. Okay. Well, thanks for being our guest, and I look forward to having you back as my guest again.
Well, it's been nice to be with you. Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
Good to be here.
Alzheimer's Association is here to share with you the research that is out there, what can we do about this disease, and also to just end the disease altogether. We want to find a cure, and the way we're going to do that is as the new research comes out, as new tests come out, new drugs are developed, we then have to ask, how much is this drug? How much are the tests? How can we get people to have access to it? So it's very exciting when they develop it, and then we have to get people rallied up behind us and go to Congress and say, you know, this is proving to show that you can actually diagnose Alzheimer's, but we need to make sure that people have access to it. And this is why advocacy and public policy is equally important as research. So they do go hand in hand.
We hope that you found the information in this program useful. It's the first of two programs on this subject. Tune in next week for Diagnosis Alzheimer's. It's about identifying the stages of the disease, options, and coping. Both programs, and all our programs, are available on VHS or DVD. You can contact us through the Cupertino Senior Center on 408-777-3150 or through our website, www.thebetterpart.com. Thank you for watching. Join us again. Thank you.